Welcome to this Bruegel event on internet taxation. It is a great pleasure to have distinguished speakers in order to analyze the debate around this issue and provide their thoughts and insights. We will start with a presentation by Francis Bloch, professor at the University of Paris and Paris School of Economics. And then we will open the floor to for a panel discussion in which we have the pleasure to have on board Caroline Edery, who is the head of unit tax administration and fight against tax fraud from European Commission, DG Exude. Dmitri Jegorov, Deputy Secretary General, Tax and Customs Policies, Estonian Ministry of Finance. Helena Kiurusalmi, Senior Tax Manager from Zalando. Yes, we have a corporate representative in the panel. Then my good friend and co-author and fellow, Scott Marcus, visiting fellow at Bruegel. After the panel discussion, we'll open the floor to all of you for questions and discussion with all the audience. Typically, as a chair, I could make an introduction to the topic, but I know that Francis is very willing also to provide this introduction, so I will give him immediately the floor. Francis, we look forward for your presentation.
Thank you. So good afternoon to everybody. And I should first thank Georgios and thank Bruegel for organizing this event. The other thing I should apologize immediately, this is going to be, I'm going to take the viewpoint of the academic. So my objective is basically to try to put things in perspective, maybe in ways that you have not thought about them before. But for the details, I'm sure that you know them better than I do. So I'm a little concerned that actually you would know more about the topic than I do, so let me apologize for that. And with no further ado, still tell you what I want to tell you today. Sorry, I should. I said I didn't need to test to try this, but. Okay. So the first point I want to make is basically how old the framework for taxation and let me start with this slide, basically just to remind you where we're coming from or why it's a hot policy debate. And I should say that actually I have decided not to give you any specific numbers because my feeling is that actually numbers are not that easy to find and not that easy to trust if you want to look at the level of taxes which are paid by the large internet platform companies. The reason why I'm saying that, and I'm happy to be contradicted, is that actually depending on the sources that you look at, basically you may have different ways in which you compute effective levels of taxation, but let me just mention something that I think everybody agrees on, which is that the effective level of taxation of those internet platforms outside the United States is in the single digits, or 4%, 5%, 6%, considered at any rate very low. And this is of particular concern, of course, to European countries. And this is a little bit where all this is really starting from, and I'll tell you exactly where we position ourselves in that debate. But we take it as given that actually there are a number of ways by which internet companies can escape taxation or reduce their level of effective taxation. And as you will soon realize, actually, I'm mostly going to be talking about direct taxation and corporate income taxation. So the first point I want to make is that we're really in a territory which has not evolved much. And in fact, by that, I really mean that the territory is much too old. As many of you probably know, the rules actually for avoiding double taxation and the rules basically regulating, telling you what you can or cannot do with transfer pricing, really date back from the League of Nations, 1928, if I'm not mistaken. So we're talking about rules which are almost a century old and have not really evolved. And a lot of the debate, and I'll turn back to that, I guess, in my conclusion, is about definitions of permanent establishment. So basically understand if you want to tax a company like Google, who can sit around the table, which are the countries which have the right to tax that platform. The second point, of course, being to know how you can divide the profit of Google among the different countries. And this is based on notions of transfer pricing, which are almost, I mean, as I said, I mean, date from 1928. And it's quite obvious when you look at it that actually the framework in which those regulations were drafted, the framework in which people thought about treaties avoiding double taxation in the 1920s was really a brick and mortar industrial world in which none of the issues that we know now with the digital economy were present. So it's obvious that this has to be adapted. And here I'll just make a short glimpse to tell you where things are happening, or things are happening everywhere, but things are in particular happening at the level of the OECD. And this is where basically since 2013, the BEPS project, so BEPS for base erosion and profit shifting, has been dedicated actually to modernize and try to get new regulations for taxation of multinationals. And let me just mention that if you look at the report of BEPS, so the latest report dates back from September 2015, in that report you see that actually digital economy is number one among the actions that BEPS wants to handle or to deal with. So it's obvious that actually the specific target they have is on the digital economy. Being here in Brussels, I should mention that actually this is not the only place where things are happening. Things are happening at all different levels. And again, I'm sure that some of you must be involved in the definition of the rules here at the European level. So I don't want to tell you what you already know or to tell you, I'm sure you know more than I do about this. So let me, you'll see at some point I'll end up telling you about things where I think I know more than you do, but for the time being, I'm still at the level where I believe that some of you in the audience may know more than I do. So again, actually, the reason why we came in is that there were a lot of policy initiatives taken by different countries, and in particular in France. And in France, it was particularly associated to the former Minister for the Economy, Arnaud Montebourg, where the idea was basically to try to discuss various proposals, which were proposal of sector-level taxes, and taxes which would be based, for example, on the number of downloads or uploads, on the number of users of a platform, where the idea, as I understand it, was since we're not able actually to get a handle on the profit of the of those internet platforms, the idea would be to look for indicators, for example, the number of users, that we can control, that we can monitor, and impose a specific tax on those companies, a kind of compensation, basically, because we could not do the first best, which would be to take a share in the corporate income tax, and just use those indicators that we can monitor, that we can look at. So in France, for example, the different proposals, and that went through different committees, different congressional committees. One was a tax levied directly on the internet service providers. Another one would be a flat tax per user. There were a proposal to base the tax on the flow of downloaded data. There were all kinds of proposals, some of which were, in my opinion, rather exotic. As far as I understand, none of them really took off and was implemented, and I think there are good reasons for that. But that's a little bit where we started entering the picture, because as you'll see in one slide, there was a group of economists in France who were commissioned by, in fact, a think tank associated to the French government, because we observed that actually there was very little discussion among economists about the issue of taxation in the digital economy. And if you looked at the academic literature, the academic literature was very, very scarce. And so that the idea was that actually we wanted, in order to improve public decision making, to try to come up with models and explain and try to understand a little bit more what the issues were for internet taxation. So now I'm talking about things on territory that is a little bit more familiar to me. So in particular, I'm going to try to explain what I think are the distinguishing features of internet taxation. The first point, and that was obvious actually talking to people involved in taxation, for example, at BEPS, is that a lot of what's happening in the internet age for the digital economy is actually exactly the same thing as is happening elsewhere in the economy. So we cannot say that, I mean, fiscal optimization, use of tax havens, use of rules for transfer pricing, for example, rules which allow you to deduct interest of loans from one country to the other, which allow you to take advantage of special provisions for use of royalties and patents. All these are used everywhere. And you can only say that actually what makes it a little bit more complex in the digital economy is that the geographic lines are blurred, and that it's sometimes uneasy to understand where a company produces. It's usually easy to see where the company delivers. But I can only say that was the first thing, is that you can only say that it's harder to establish jurisdiction in the digital economy as it was before, but the questions are exactly the same. In addition, as I write here, marginal costs are very low. So what marginal costs, what I mean by that is that actually, it's going to be very, very, if you look at Google, for example, providing a search for an additional user is going to represent a cost close to zero. Most of the cost of internet platforms is sunk in the development of algorithms. So what that means is that actually, this gives the firms a kind of incentive actually to produce as much as they can. It makes everything go faster. I mean, it makes it harder to trace what's going on because there is no physical production of something that would take time or would be costly. Another part is that actually, and that's most interesting for us, and that I want to really draw your attention to that, is that internet firms are two-sided platforms. What I mean by that is that actually they are a point of exchange between two sides of the market, for example, users and advertisers. That would be the case for the search engines. And that's going to be one of the takeaways from my talk, is going to change the intuitions that we have from traditional taxation. So the fact that we're sitting in a two-sided platform really means that some taxes are going to be more harmful than others, whereas they are actually better than others in a context which is a traditional context. A new phenomenon is that we collect and use data, or companies collect and use data. So I'm not going to, so many people are talking about big data that I don't need to convince you, but that is really specific to the internet platforms, and that also is going to change issues of taxation, because it's going to raise issues like how can we use taxation in order to affect the behavior of those internet platforms if we believe, for example, that they don't abide by the rules in terms of protecting privacy, and then we may want to use taxation as an instrument, as well as regulation, basically to make them behave. And finally, and that's something that I also want to draw your attention to, but I don't know how to handle, this is a market in which there are large network effects. What I mean by that is that if you look at a social networking platform, if you create the real value of Facebook is really the fact that everybody coordinates on the same platform. What that means is that if tomorrow people were just to switch and to move to a different platform because it's more efficient, because it's more user-friendly, then you would have enormous changes. So there's a lot of variability or a lot of variance in the evolution of the industry. We don't know whether the big players of today are going to remain the big players of tomorrow. And that also means something in terms of taxation. I'm going to try to convince you of. It basically means that there are rents that those platforms capture. For example, Facebook captures rents just because it exists and just because everybody is there, without really investing any particular money in Facebook. So basically, it collects rents because it's a coordination device. And this is something that we could tax with absolutely no distortion in the economy because this is just a rent. So that's one of the... I'm not going fast enough, Giorgio, so I'm... Okay, this is what I'm not going to be talking about, even though it may be of interest to all of you. It's basically the issues of VAT and indirect taxation. So let me just skip that. So tell you basically where we're coming from. So as I said, this is coming from a study that we did, which is public, actually, that you can find on the website of France Stratégie. So France Stratégie is a think tank linked to the Prime Minister's office. It's the current version of what used to be the Commissariat Général au Plan, which is really a think tank, but I'm actually not really able to identify what are the real links to the government, except that actually in March 2015, we actually presented our report to Axel Le Maire, who's the French Minister or Secretary of State in charge of the digital economy. This is also part, we discussed this with people at BEPS at OECD, so this is, and we are now doing a follow-up study with people at BEPS at OECD. Okay. So let me try to very briefly give you three ideas, which are ideas coming from the academic literature, and I'm going to be using three papers very briefly. The first one is actually a paper which was written by some of our Norwegian and Swiss colleagues in 2008 and 2010. And this is a paper that I recommend you should read if you want to look at this, where let me mention that this is the first paper which basically asks the question, what happens to taxation when we have a two-sided platform? And, I may have done some. Thank you.
You should be able to sit here too.
Okay. So the main point that they're making is that actually, in a two-sided platform, what you do on one side is going to affect the other. So in other words, if you impose a tax on advertisers, it means that actually users, you are going to reduce the level of advertising in the platform, and that may actually reduce the number of users. So you are going to have, if you have fewer advertisers, you'll have fewer users. If you have fewer users, you'll have fewer advertisers. So what that means is that actually there are interactions between the two sides of the platform, and one thing which comes out of what they're doing is basically to compare what is an ad valorem tax. So as economists, we think that ad valorem taxes are much better than unit taxes. You should actually tax on the value, because this is not going to be distortive, whereas if you tax on the number of units, you are going to change the prices, and by changing the prices, you are going to distort the signals that people use in their production and consumption decisions. So the traditional perspective is that actually you should always use an ad valorem tax rather than unit tax. I'm just claiming that here, what they show is that this may not be the case. So you may actually have an incentive here to do the opposite. You may have an incentive actually to do the opposite and to start imposing unit taxes rather than ad valorem taxes. And the reason for that is that actually unit taxes may actually help you prevent excessive development on the platform. So the idea is that there may be too much development on the platform. The fact that one side retroacts on the other side, in some situations may actually, you may want to limit this. The second paper I want to discuss very briefly is one of the papers in our study, where the idea was to start with the same model, but really take into account the fact that you had data provision and data collection. And in that model, basically what is going on is that the users are going to decide how much data they upload on the website, and revenues are going to be collected both fiscal revenues are first collected through VAT revenues, in the sense that advertisers basically are going to collect revenues when they make a sale. And we're looking at what would happen if, in addition to that, you would also impose a tax on data collection. So here the idea was really to try to approach what would be a tax, which is a tax specifically on the number, on the flow of data which is uploaded. And the result which is obtained in that study is, is that if you introduce a small tax on data, this may actually increase fiscal revenues, but only if you have, if the VAT rate is small enough. So the idea is that there is a negative interaction between a tax on the data and VAT. And the reason for that is quite obvious, is that if you have a tax, you are actually going to reduce the amount of trade that you're going to create, and that's going to have a negative effect on the VAT. Another thing which I think is important here is basically to say that if you start imposing a tax, you may actually change the business model of the platform. And the idea is that you may actually, by imposing a tax on advertisers, for example, you may eventually lead the platform, if it doesn't have enough advertising revenues, to start collecting revenues on the other side of the market. So basically to start collecting revenue on users. So what we believe is that actually one negative effect of data, of taxes on data, may actually be that you are going to reduce access to the platform, and you're going to make the platform impose a price, start pricing on the user side, which may in some ways eliminate the number of agents who are going to be accessing the platform. The last paper I want to discuss very briefly is a paper I participated in. The only difference we have in that, between that paper and the previous one, is that we're now considering that the amount of data which is collected and exploited is not a decision of the consumer, but a decision of the platform. And what we're looking at is, how is it possible basically to try to encourage the platform, for example, to destroy data or to give access to data after a period, not to keep histories which are too long, et cetera, et cetera. And here the main idea in economics is what's called Pigovian taxation. It's the idea that if you have a very specific tax which is imposed, then that may actually change the behavior and reduce the externalities that you, that, that the platform creates. And the point we make is that actually this is not necessarily the case. And so what we're looking at is, what is the effect of taxation on the choice of the platform, how much data the platform is going to collect and exploit. And the first point is that an ad valorem tax will not change the behavior of the platform. And this is due to the fact that I repeated that ad valorem taxes typically have no distortive effect on the decisions of companies. We show that if you use a tax per user, this is actually going to induce the platform to increase the amount of data collection. And the reason for that is that actually it means that it's going to make it, it's not going to change how, for the people who are currently accessing the platform, the benefit that you get from data collection, but it's going to change how much you get when a new user enters the platform. And so it may actually reduce your incentive to bring in users to the platform and exploit the users who are currently in the platform. So what we really believe should be done is a tax which differentiates between two users of data. One use would be a one-time use, for example, a Google search which immediately gives you the list of advertisers on the keyword, but so that maybe we should not tax, but we should definitely tax whenever Google resells histories of searches, or whoever uses, for example, for dynamic pricing, large databases. So our point is that we should differentiate between what's a one-use use of data and what would be collecting and keeping data for future use. Let me use the 5 minutes I have to basically go back to what I think are the main takeaway messages of our study. So the first one is about taxation of network rents. So as I said, internet platforms collect network rents because of the positions as intermediaries, but they did nothing to get that position. So taxing those profits or those revenues should actually not affect the behavior of the companies. And you can think that actually you have all that taxable base, which exists without, again, I would almost say without any particular effort from those platforms, and that is something that you can tax and that you should tax. The only negative argument that I can see is that if you start taxing, you are going to reduce the incentives to do R&D or to improve the quality of the service, And I believe that actually this, so you really have to trade off what would be the dynamic aspects of taxing those rents versus the fact that those rents actually are there and are there to be taxed. Exclusion on two-sided markets. Here I want to call your attention to what I just mentioned, the fact that actually if you start taxing, for example, advertisers, this may actually lead the platform to shift revenues on the other side, which in turn is going to mean that they're going to start collecting revenues from the users, and we are going to change completely the world in which we are towards a world in which Google, for example, may charge for the service. And the negative aspect I see from this is that this is going to exclude from internet usage, of course, the weakest and the weakest fraction of the population. So this is definitely something that exclusion is something that we should take into account. Taxation and privacy protection. My point here is that I want to decompose, I want to be a little bit more precise on how you use data and decompose the one-time access and revenues generated by data collection and storage. I believe that data collection by platform is excessive from the point of view of users, even if you take into account the fact that users do benefit from the fact that they have better targeted ads and better targeted suggestions, for example, with Amazon, because data are stored. So I'm not saying that users do not benefit from the fact that platforms use the data, but I'm saying that platforms have a stronger incentive to exploit the data, and we should correct for that. And I suggest that a tax differentiating between source of revenues is the right way of doing this. As I write, an alternative, actually, which would be to give the user the possibility to opt out. For example, this is something which is currently being more and more implemented. Basically, you offer premium versions where the consumer can opt out of some data collection and exploitation. This may actually be harmful, because this may mean that actually those users who are not going to access the premium service but who are going to continue to use the basic free service are going to be exploited more than they were before. Interaction of fiscal instruments. Here the point is that you cannot really dissociate the different fiscal instruments. So if you think about using sector-based taxes like a tax based on data collection, you have to realize that this is going to also affect the revenues that you collect on trade, on VAT. So that was the point of one of the papers I discussed, which was basically saying that you do not want to reduce the amount of activity or trade on internet platforms, because this will have negative effects on VAT. The other point is that if you compare taxes on data and advertising, so you ask yourself, should I tax one side of the market or the other, they are not equivalent. And in fact, one of the papers shows that taxing advertising results typically will result in more distortions than tax on data. And this is due to the fact that actually there is a price for advertising, whereas there is no explicit price for data. So if you tax advertising, actually, you are going to affect the way the market behaves in a way which is not the case when you tax data, which, at least for the moment, do not have an explicit monetary price. Finally, taxation and competition. Here, my point is that actually, as I said, this is an environment which I believe can move really fast. So taxation also has a lot of competitive effects. It affects the way that actually platforms compete against one another across countries. It may actually, and one thing that we found in one of our models is that actually taxation may be bad for the smaller platforms when you have two asymmetric platforms. So we have one version of the model where we have competition between two platforms. One is smaller, the other one is larger. And what we see is that taxation actually hurts more the smaller platform than the large platform. Let me conclude by telling you basically what I think the open issues are and what we should be thinking about, and basically what the second stage of the study is going to talk about. So one aspect, of course, is the redefinition of the permanent establishment. So we want to move out of the 1928 definition and see basically how to redefine it. I think as economists, I don't know what we can say. We can say much more about the second bullet point here, which is make proposals for sharing across countries. And in particular, one thing that we're working on now, and I think that's going to be the main point of the second part of the study, is to understand better what information sharing among countries on fiscal basis, how this affects the way that you can tax multinationals. Second point is basically a proposal. The proposal actually defended by the OECD is to think about a withholding tax. So basically to imagine that you have at a fixed rate a withholding tax on internet transactions, and we want to study what this would lead to. And finally, all this has to be quantified. So you have not seen a single figure in everything I showed you, except for the figures that I did not believe in the first slide. So we need to know, we need to quantify, we need to fine-tune, and to understand better what small changes in taxation, for example, in the withholding tax, would do to activity of internet platforms, and that's what we're hoping to do in the future.
Thank you very much, Francis, for this comprehensive analysis of academic literature and the summary of the main results. I think it is a very nice illustration that good academic research can produce some clear messages that should be part of the discussion by the policy and corporate world. Three points that I found particularly interesting from this presentation is that taxation, when the platforms, they have relatively high fixed costs, then can affect their investment strategies and investments in R&D. That, of course, creates further questions and the necessity to look at particular figures and data, what is the scale effect, whether there is any optimal scale of taxation in or, which allow us to avoid this particular negative effect on R&D. Another important point is that taxation should be seen in relationship to the business model and can disrupt the business model of the online online platforms. And the question then is if we carefully can design the tax system, the tax rules to be implemented in a way to avoid negative disruptive effects. And another important point that is the one of competition. Competition cannot solve anything, everything, but in this case probably will affect more negatively the small platforms if we are in an environment in which competitors, they are asymmetric, we have big and small platforms. We can go further into the discussion, but let me give the floor to Helena, the tax manager of Zalando. It will be great to have your thoughts, and especially on topics related to the impact of taxation on corporations.
Okay, thank you very much, and thanks for the invitation as well. And thanks for Francis for starting this discussion. So of course for companies like Zalando I'm coming from, is a lot of those challenges are related to this the global mindset which we have in internet and e-commerce business towards against this local taxation mindset, which is still a lot in practice. And of course this brings the biggest challenge is like we have to somehow build the business on online global mindset, but then be in compliance with the local tax authorities. The other one is, of course, this internet business is very fast-moving. It's very unpredictable at this moment. It's very innovative, and it's very technical. And there is no certainty what is going to happen in next in the business side, in e-commerce. But on the other hand, it's also in very unpredictable on the law side and authority side. So this is sometimes I feel as a tax person in this kind of company, I'm like a buffer between two of these sides, like I have the feeling like every day I have to somehow invent the new definitions of the goods or what is the service again. And also we have a lot of like new business ideas coming from the business side, and we don't have like a classical model existing for these ones. And then if we start to think about the taxation, where it should be taxed, what's the value generated by this business. And of course this is something which brings for us a lot of challenges. And of course, this is very fascinating, But I mean, sometimes I really need to get into those, I don't know, what developers are doing, what are the value creation in this value chain, and then try to bring it up on how do we tax this and where do we tax these creations. Okay, maybe some more detailed challenges which we have, and what has been discussed a lot is, of course, this VAT challenge. The company like us has to comply the local tax rules in more than, I think, 15 countries at this moment. And online business is like very easy to set up, so it takes, I don't know, 10 minutes for the good quarter to set up an online store. But the other question is then when you can start to sell through these online stores. And this is something we are actually struggling basically every day. So getting, for example, a VAT registration from some of those countries takes 2 or 3 months. So this is kind of making the business go slowly to start. And this is also, of course, difficult to smaller e-commerce companies. Like, these rules are done more on the big multinationals, so they are able to comply with the local rules. And of course, this increases our costs a lot. We are very dependent on the external advisory companies in these countries. And of course, it's also a compliance challenge for us. So every month we need to comply these rules and try to file the VAT returns to every single country on a timely basis. And one topic which I like to raise is actually not discussed so much in this area is the people deployment challenge. Like as said, internet is a global platform. Basically, we could hire a people wherever we want. But this is not possible, or basically it is possible, but then we come right away in a question that do we have, for example, a permanent establishment in this country if we are using some developer from the United States or from the UK or from the Spain, or some stylisters for our online store from Switzerland or from Austria. And this also brings many times for us that we are performing as an employers for these freelance spaces people. So this is also, like I would say, a big burden if we are using only one person in one company, in one country. Then something what was also discussed by Francis, for us the data is at this moment a very, very big challenge. And also the other hard-to-value intangibles, like, for example, open source softwares, what are developed at this moment. Of course, the quickest question is how do we evaluate these? What's the valuation of these products? These are shared very easily inside of the groups, so it's even hard for us to keep a track where, for example, data is going on, where it is scattered, where is it used, where it is enriched, and to whom it's provided in the end. Or in respect of, for example, data, the legislation is coming like afterwards. So now we have to really set up these principles and how do we think about this from the business point of view. So legislation might come afterwards or maybe next year or a year after, and then we need to probably change all of these setups again. And of course, it's something our whole company is still a bit on toes about these issues, because this is something which might change a lot. And also, as mentioned, this might actually change the definition of the permanent establishment in the end, that if we have some data gathering in some of the country, it might be actually a B issue for us in the end. And one additional topic, what I have noticed now while I have been working in Zalando, like all of these transactions, like we were talking about data gathering, data exploitation, advertisements, and so on, like this can be so integrated transactions that it's actually even very difficult to distinguish what is the transaction itself. It's like, I would say that the value chain itself in this area has been making more blur, and I think it's more like iterative process all the time. So everything is coming inside of the process again, and something is again going outside of the process, and it is kind of iterating all the time the data gathering and exploitation and some products which we are developed over these data issues, for example. Okay, and some possible solutions. For us, I would say it's of course always around this tax compliance side. Like I would say, like we have a lot of recommendations from the authority side, or Francis also mentioned something that there should be maybe have a permanent establishment for data purposes in some of the countries, but maybe there should be done one layer more for the tax authority level, so it would be easier to us to discuss, for example, some euro level tax authorities to discuss about these topics. And
Helena, in order to give also the floor to the other speakers, want to make a main message, concluding message, and we can continue the discussion.
Okay, yeah, maybe the main issue would be just that the authorities would think really about this compliance side, that how the companies would be the most easiest and flexible way to comply these requirements what are now presented.
Thank you very much. It is good to know from a person that works in the industry the real challenges and how really dynamic is the market, especially when we go to value-generated products and services. Caroline, your view on this topic?
Yes, thank you. Good afternoon, and thank you also for inviting me to this panel. I think this is a very interesting topic that we're discussing today, because we are in the middle of discussing the digital economy, which everybody's interested in, but also how we ensure tax compliance in this area. And I think you both raised the issue. Listening to you is indeed about what we will call in French le civisme fiscal. How do we ensure that in this environment? You didn't speak about VAT, so I will talk about it actually, but mainly from the VAT collection side and indeed compliance and enforcement. So as you know, the Commission has taken a very clear stance on the digital economy. In the context of the digital agenda, the Commission wants to support the boosting of the economy, but at the same time provide consumers with adequate protection. And it means that in the area of VAT, we consider that all market operators, be they individuals or established companies, have to comply with taxation rules in force, and we do not foresee any special rules applying for online traders. So that's a key principle for us, to ensure that all companies are treated the same way. But of course, this is a challenge for ensuring the proper collection of the VAT. And it's true that when we talk about the destination principle in the VAT area, we are aware that the businesses are facing different rules and different systems in different countries of destination in the EU. So that's why we have been working on a simplification mechanism that we are testing now since the 1st of January 2015. That allows businesses to register and comply with VAT obligations in one single EU member states instead of having to carry out the formalities in all member states of consumption. So this simplification is called a mini one-stop shop, and it applies precisely to companies dealing with telecommunications, electronic services and broadcasting. Of course, the other problem that we have with this destination principle is enforcement in the country of taxation, which depends very much on the cooperation with the country where the seller is established and where he makes his, he fulfills his VAT obligations. So the way we approach it for the future is twofold. First, we would like to further increase the simplification measures for the businesses, and on the other hand, work more on cooperation strategies to ensure the enforcement. So as regards the simplification measures, We have announced in the VAT action plan that we published in April that the Commission will come up with a legislative proposal. And the idea would be to extend this MOS to all kind of intra-EU and extra-EU online supplies of goods and services. And then we are also looking at ways of facilitating small startup e-commerce businesses. That's the issue of setting a threshold. Then would like to look at ways of introducing home country controls to really define which tax authority is responsible for controlling in the context of the MOS. And then also we are looking at removing the VAT exemption on the small consignments from suppliers in third countries and for distant selling in the EU, because we recognize now that with the increase of online supplies, then we have unfair competition in the market and we have to correct this. So that's more for the legislative aspects and simplification. When it comes to cooperation, well, as you said, you are acting on a global market, but you have to deal with national administrations, with national rules. So here the idea is that we want to engage with national tax administrations in the EU, but also with third countries and business operators to see how we make compliance work in this complex environment to ensure that we do not reduce actually the revenues from the governments while supporting the development of the of this market. So when it comes to third countries, because a lot of providers are established outside the EU, we are now negotiating an agreement with Norway on administrative cooperation and fight against fraud. So that will be a sort of model agreement, and we will test whether such cooperation can help us, in particular in the area of e-commerce. And that could be then the model for further agreements for cooperation with bigger countries in terms of supply to the EU market. Then when it comes to cooperation with business, as you know, we are animating the EU VAT Forum, which is a forum where tax administrations from the member states meet with businesses to discuss practical aspects of VAT compliance. And there we have published also in April a guide on cooperation between administrations and companies to fight VAT fraud. And now we are envisaging to broaden the scope of the guide to also cover cooperation in the area of e-commerce. And then we would like also to engage with the internet platforms and engage them in cooperation with tax administrations. So there we will review what exists today at national level and then also suggest, after discussion with stakeholders, ways of proceeding with this. So all in all, we know very well what are the challenges both for tax administrations and companies, and we are well aware that we have to tackle these issues now because the market will further develop, and we need to make sure that we have we facilitate the cooperation between tax administrations and companies. Thank you
very much, Caroline. It's good to have an overview of all the measures and approach of the Commission that. And I believe that the simplification measures that you mentioned will be also very helpful given the challenges and the dynamic challenges that Helena mentioned. But also the enforcement issue is a big issue that we need to think very carefully how to proceed. Of course, talking about European approach on taxation, Estonia seemed to be a very particular example that it is worth spending some time to illustrate the main points of this example and what is the general philosophy and approach and how also you can comment on that issues like enforcement, like simplification rules that already mentioned and the challenges for the companies. Dmitri, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Georgios. First of all, thanks to Bruegel for organizing this event. and for inviting me to be on the panel, and thank you all for coming. It's really comforting to see so many people interested in taxation and taxation in relation to internet. We'll present some slides in order for you to follow my presentation a bit easier. To speak about internet taxation and the main problem, we do have to define what the main problem is, and it looks like the definition of permanent establishment, where we're soon will be celebrating 100 years of this concept that is not exactly essential to digital economy, because in our view, it relies on locations and on people, and for many businesses in the digital economy, none of this is essential as for a conventional business. So this residence-based principle indeed can be outdated. So whether the source principle or whether customers are, where the value is sourced from, is that the key to solving this problem? After all, the businesses have understood this for a long time, that customers are indeed the greatest value of any business. And so while we are now dealing with redefining the old concepts, you know, warehousing may be not an auxiliary activity, but one of the key activities that creates a permanent establishment, and server location as a link to a permanent establishment, we're dealing with redefining exclusions which might not be actual for the digital economy, if not now, then in the near future, because, you know, just-in-time has been invented. You don't need a lot of warehousing for many products, and you don't need warehousing for services. And cloud computing, you know, it loses the need for a server at all. So what is that location where value is created? I therefore agree with Professor Bloch's first question. So what to do with the permanent establishment? Is virtual permanent establishment actually a key? And, you know, we have some member states in OECD who are opposing or who are not very clear on liking the virtual permanent establishment. You know, if you think about businesses and where most of these internet businesses come from, then you understand who I'm talking about. So consider a case, you know, a clothing company, a standard clothing company, closes down its stores and goes virtual. And for now, you know, website is not a PE in most cases. Designers and managers become virtual nomads. You know, they can have Estonian type e-residence that gives them the right to use digital government services wherever they are in the world, as long as they have internet. Products may be presumption is when consumers participate in the production of products. You know, sales are automated, and there are no servers. There's cloud-based production, no salespeople, no servers, no or limited warehousing. You know, a whole lot of value is still created, but the only suitable basis for cross-border allocation in this case is probably where the customers are. So this is a good case to give to five lawyers, because I guarantee you get six replies of where the value is created, and you'd be lucky to get only six. So we do have a lot of questions remaining here. Now we have a little technical difficulties. Yeah, now we go. I'll be a little bit provoking in this slide. Do we actually need a corporate income tax? You know, value, what is value? It's sales minus costs, and sales can be allocated and costs can be allocated. But of course, the problem is that those allocations are mismatched. Is there actually a better allocation than pro rata sales-based allocation of costs within the same group? You know, the risks may be nominally attributed to a subsidiary, but essentially, isn't any and every risk attributable to the whole group, or to the whole business? And, you know, the concept of allocating costs actually is from the time when we had factories, very geographical factories. You know, you had to be in specific location. And back at that time, did we actually think that business can be demand-driven, that it can be customer-oriented? You know, we very much depended on the location. And, of course, costs were connected to that location. But costs are no longer local. Costs can be very global in the world today. So, and in effect, corporation is fiction. You know, there are, it's a legal body without a body. You know, there are natural persons behind every one of them, behind every corporation. So natural persons have personal income tax rate. Perhaps a corporate income tax rate can be a sum of all PIT rates of its shareholders. One crazy idea. So what could be the steps to the solution of this problem? The competition problem, as Professor Bloch has outlined, is indeed a very big problem. You know, it can be a global problem and it can be a local problem. So for global problem or cross-border problem, Facebook, Google, other companies, you know, they have chunked out a significant portion of almost every local ad market. We've just spoken about the internet trade. You know, AliExpress and Amazon are the world's department stores. Also local competition, Airbnb versus hotels, Uber, Taxify, and taxis. We're actually, in Estonia, Uber, Taxify drivers can submit income data electronically to the tax authorities. This has been a cooperation between the tax authorities and Uber, and we're looking to legislate their existence in close cooperation with Uber, actually. Various other areas, e-papers versus e-books versus paper books. You know, there are many examples of where the way of doing business has changed. And so, one of the first solutions that we see, and I personally believe that this is where we have to start, is increasing transparency. OECD and EU both are working on it, and the transparency to the tax authorities, and perhaps even transparency to the public by publishing where how much is earned and where the taxes are paid, so that we can realize if it's a big problem and how big and exactly where it is. And my last slide with some substance on it is that some countries are honest, you know, but they still face the same problem. Not every country is a Panama, you know, and I apologize to anyone who may feel offended by that. We have a concept of e-residence, as I said, is an Estonian concept of virtual citizenship. You can apply for e-residence card, a chip card that will give you a verified digital access to government e-services. Includes a timestamp, secure digital signature. It's not a right, it's a privilege that can be revoked, although it's open to everyone. Of course, we have to evaluate the money laundering risks that can be connected to it. It's not a substitute for passport or visas, but the digital signature is legally binding. So you have to take care of what you're actually signing, and it's a perfect instrument for being a digital nomad. You can actually go in business being everywhere and anywhere in the world. Companies can be set up in minutes, bank accounts can be opened, taxes can be e-filed. It opens prospects, actually, for us, the state, to offer services like accounting in one country and then transferring the profit tax to other countries. But there is a big question, just as I started. We face the same problem. How? On basis of what rules do we transfer the right profit tax to the right country? So this question remains open. And here's just in short a slide of what I said. In the whole presentation. The features of a PE approach, location of people, are indeed outdated, I agree. Without customers, no value is created, but customers still have locations, yet. You know, shareholders yet have locations, so we do have some points there on which to rely. The crucial question is transparency. I think that this is a good way to solve the problem if you can identify the problem clearly. And some countries do not create problems, but they face the same challenges with these ambiguous rules, and that's why we need solutions. Thank you.
Dmitri, thanks so much. Thanks for pointing out this transparency argument is something that I hope will motivate some discussion, and also this member states' view on the topic that could also bring some arguments on whether how we can agreed to common rules in the European-wide way, and whether this is necessary. But before that, let's go to the final speaker for today, Scott. Scott, I got the feeling that you have you want to comment on VAT, but feel free to go also more general.
Oh, I want to comment on everything. But first, I'd like to thank Professor Bloch and also the panelists for quite wonderful remarks. It's really a great pleasure to be here today. I think that the analysis that we started with from Professor Bloch is really quite fascinating, raises a lot of questions. I think it's important to remember that we're really, in some ways, at the beginning rather than at the end of a discussion. Some of the words that I heard frequently from Professor Bloch were not necessarily, and I think those are important words here. A clear issue is that in today's electronic era, that as we've heard from pretty much every panelist, the location of a corporation, of an entity, matters far less than it used to. And that's true whether we have goods that are electronically ordered or services that are electronically ordered. The goods at least have to be transported. That means that there's some locus that matters, perhaps, but that's not necessarily the locus from which they're ordered. In the case of goods, they can really be ordered from anywhere to anywhere. So we live in a much more complicated world than we used to. As far as corporate tax, I think it's inevitable in a world like this that we would see something of a race to the bottom. And I think this is the question that's at root of a lot of the discussion. And then the question is basically, how does that get solved? Pumping money out of the corporations that seem to be evading what they ought to pay sounds like a useful thing to do. But the natural question is, how much, and how do you do that without introducing distortions? So to me, those are some key issues. Now, the detailed economics, I mean, the principles are great. Everybody loves two-sided markets. What they tell us is, of course, that both subscription and usage elasticities are crucial. This is what you want to promote. And, of course, those are the things that drive typical ad valorem taxation. So you know, all of these things I think we very much agree on. But then when you get into the detailed analysis, there are lots of different business models here. There are many underlying assumptions in the work, including, as Professor Bloch noted, the question, do the business models stay constant when the taxation model changes? So I think the results have to be treated with a lot of caution, which is why I think, again, we're really much more at the beginning of an assessment than at an end. And in particular, then, what are the risks associated with some of the solutions? Would a change in taxation policy, a fundamental change, would it hit the right parties? Would it take the right amount of money? And what distortions might it risk? And here, coming back actually to Carolyn's remarks, I think there's some useful lessons we can take from VAT policy and from VAT concerns. So here I come back to Georgios' point. If you look at some of the recent literature, for example, studies that have been done for the European Parliament in 2012 and for the Commission in 2015, we see a number of different concerns. One is with the fact that we have different value-added tax rates in different member states and often different rates for different kinds of products, including different rates for electronic versus physical products. We have the low-value consignment rule, which I think everybody acknowledges has caused distortions. And we also have an important shift to taxation at the destination, at the point of consumption, which probably is a very important and crucial refinement in trying to get the system on a more rational basis. It does have one negative, and that is that for the supplier, it implies having to deal with rules from multiple countries. You touched on this in your remarks, Helena. So particularly for small and medium enterprise, there, to the extent that rules can be based on origin, it would be useful, or to the extent that rules could all be the same would be even better, right? wishful thinking, but you know, this may actually be the end game. This may actually be where we ultimately want to get to. Now, one particular concern, though, that shows up in the literature on this is different rates of taxation for physical versus virtual goods. This has come up in a couple of the remarks. And we have this, for example, for e-books. You could think about CDs versus streamed music or DVDs versus streamed video as examples. I mean, DVDs are fading a bit, but I think the discussion is still there. The issue will be with us. To the extent that we have different conditions for physical versus virtual goods, it tends also to lead to distortions. And particularly to the extent that these are different in different member states, it leads to distortions. One of the more persuasive recommendations that shows up in some of the work that's been done for the European institutions is to try to bring these into alignment, you know, presumably at least in the country of destination, so as to reduce distortion. But actually for that reason, I also have some concerns that some of the more radical approaches that show up in some of the papers that Professor Bloch was quoting might actually make that problem worse rather than better. So with that, once again, I'd like to thank everybody for a quite fascinating discussion, and back to you, Georgios.
Thanks so much, Scott, for the very insightful comments on the topic. So before I let the speakers react to each other's comments, I suggest to open the floor for questions, collect questions, and then we come back and forth. So please, if you have any question, do not hesitate to ask. Please identify yourself before. Yeah.
Yes, good afternoon. My name is Friedrich de Bakker. I work for Telefonica. I'm not a tax expert at all, so I live that every year and I have to make my income tax. But I have, starting from the beginning of the presentation of Francis, stating the problem with the comparison of the corporate tax rates that Google pays in the US compared to the rest of the US, which is like the 19% versus 6%, which seems like the kind of eventually the problem we want to address here. And I have understood well, at the end of your presentation, you said things that should be looked again at was the issue of permanent establishment. While when I understood from Dimitri's presentation that you actually would rather abandon the concept. So it's quite conflicting views, or do I understand it wrongly?
Any other question before we go to the answers? Yes, please. If you can approach a microphone, would have been great. Ah, okay, great. Thank you. One third question before we go to the first round of answers. Okay, I will leave you think about any potential thing you want to ask, since I don't see any hand raised. Let's go to the answer. So I guess, Francis, Dmitri, you want to address the first question.
Actually, I would be in favor of abandoning completely the notion of permanent establishment. I mean, I don't know, I don't think it's politically practical or feasible, but my feeling is that actually this is a two-stage process where you first decide who can sit around the table and then how do you divide the profits in the table. So I don't see why you should have the two-stage process, I think. You may think actually of treating everybody. It's mostly a practical problem, I guess, that you don't want to have 150 countries around the table. But I think it's totally outdated.
Thank you. That was actually a very interesting question. My point was that when we're trying to redefine permanent establishment, is that we're trying to modify something that probably doesn't work in the first place any longer for the digital economy. Because what is permanent in digital economy, my first question? And my second question, where is the establishment in this virtual world? So a virtual P actually has surfaced as a topic in the discussion, and I guess it will be, you know, for the permanent establishment as such, for standard permanent establishments, it will be all the countries in the world, every country in the world, and for virtual P, there will be plus one, so the internet, kind of a global sphere. So, but as long as any solution that works for taxing the value, and then assigning the value to group of people, basically a country, that feels they have the most connection to this value. I hope we can find something that allows us to drop the permanent establishment for the digital economy.
Thank you. Is there any other comment from the panel on this? No. Okay, so let's go to the second question about the tax structure. Anyone who wants to address this? Caroline, any view on that?
I can comment. Thank you. That was also a very interesting question. I think it is changing. Digital economy, and we heard it actually from Carolina, you know, that VAT is changing. I mean, it's not a tax mix, but still it's changing the way we apply the rules. I think Scott actually commented very well on the effects that digital economy can have. Perhaps, again, not on tax and tax rates. Yes, on tax rates, not on taxes. Look at e-books versus conventional books. What is an e-book? It's a file, you know. And for countries that want to tax e-books with a reduced VAT rate, basically, what is a file? It's zeros and ones. So you're looking into a combination of zeros and ones, and you say, boom, reduced rate. You know, where for other files of other combinations of ones and zeros, you say, no, standard rate of VAT. So this creates some complications. And of course, VAT is not a substitute for corporate income tax. You know, if you tax something with a VAT and it's an input for a business, it gets credited. And basically, there's no tax, effectively, there's no tax collected. In terms of other taxes versus corporate income tax, and I think Professor Bloch actually touched upon that, if you cannot tax with corporate income tax, perhaps you can come up with some solution to tax something. But that's actually, I mean, if you're talking about profit tax, it's really difficult to tax something else other than profits. So it's okay to tax something else if you cannot tax with corporate income tax, but I'd rather find a solution to tax with corporate income tax as long as it is.
Thank you, Dmitri. Any other question, comment, suggestion, remark? Yes, please.
Thank you very much. My name is Wolfgang Papa. I'm associated with SEPS here in Brussels now after having served in the Commission. I wonder, you all more or less emphasize how difficult it is to go beyond the nation state here, because it's a matter of global issues here. And I haven't heard of any initiative at the United Nations or any multilateral institution so far in this regard. Do you know of any initiative or anything going on which I would call omnilateral? It cannot be only multi, it has to be omnibus. Thank you.
Yeah, James Watson from Business Europe. I mean, I think we'd certainly agree with the points Mr. Jegorov made at the end there. We'd see the answer to a lot of these questions about reforming the corporate tax system in the way that we're doing through the OECD and through BEPS, and making sure that that works as well for the digital sectors, rather than trying to dream up new ways of new types of taxation, as we saw some of the things that you'd thought about for the French think tank. I think Europe's got enough taxes, and particularly if we want to develop Europe as a centre for these sort of companies, we shouldn't be thinking of new ways of taxing them in addition. And just to illustrate that point, I just had an additional question. We talked about possibly, I think you talked about Facebook and a sort of network tax on them, and you considered the impact on R&D for that particular company. It just occurred to me, had you thought about how a taxation system, if you think at the top of the pyramid like that, how that would feed right down, and if we think about the venture capital industry, how that might affect investment in venture capital if companies are thinking, investors are thinking, well, you know, it may be the next big thing, but if they're thinking, well, it may be the next big thing, but then it's going to get taxed anyway. So the extent to which a tax at the top, if you like, of the pyramid might impact on investment all the way through, right down to the bottom. I just wondered to the extent you thought about that. Thanks.
One third question before we go to the answers.
Jan Hoekman from FDI Consulting. I thought Helena's comments on the difficulty to actually decompose a service or a data into its constituent parts, and that makes it quite difficult to tax, I found that very interesting. And I was wondering whether, for example, Francis Bloch, you had this also in mind when you came up with your solutions, but because it seems that maybe some of your recommendations would not actually help to, you know, decrease compliance costs, which apparently is a big issue for companies, but rather sort of increase it, so sort of not simplifying what is already quite a complex system.
So, you want to step in, starting? Yeah, please.
Okay, I want to make a few comments because actually from different parts of the audience, I get the feeling that you think that my policy recommendations are bold and that I'm in favor of taxation. I have to give you a little bit of the context. When actually we presented the report, I was definitely against any new tax. And what I tried to explain to the minister was that what you had to do is basically to work in BEPS and get corporate income tax and not create new sector-based tax. You also have to understand the French context. So I sat in a panel once about what they call sector-based taxation, and I think there are more than 1,500 different taxes in France which are sector-based. So if you're in the transportation industry, for example, you are liable, I think, to 300 different levels of taxation. So I'm definitely, and I'm trying to answer both comments, I'm definitely not in favor of having a new tax on data. Our objective was to try to give an assessment, and we also believe that politically this is not going to happen. So so we think that actually the only possible danger in France would be a tax based on ISP, so that's something which may happen. I don't think there's going to be any tax on data, and we're definitely against it. So I just want to set the record straight.
Thank you. Any other position? Someone wants?
Yeah, there was a question of everyone saying it's so difficult, but is anyone doing anything about it? Actually, under OECD, I can give you an example. First, there was one of the actions of BEPS that was focused on digital economy. It didn't go far. It didn't go that far as it was expected, so it doesn't actually offer many solutions, but it actually outlines very well the problems that are connected to digital economy. And the work is continuing in OECD. There is a task force on digital economy, and they're expecting, I guess, more or less concrete solutions by 2020. So hopefully, they will be applicable and well thought through.
Thank you. Any others? Yeah, please.
I would just like to confirm the feeling is that we have a global market and national territories, and I think it's here to stay for a while. So, and as you said, we are not aware of any larger initiative where we will try to go further than that. At least at EU level, we try to approach it more on a general, more global level, but we stick to the national territories. But that's why, as you said, instead of inventing new taxes at national level, it's important that we try to ensure a proper collection of the taxes that exist within the internal market and possibly also with third countries and suppliers from third countries. I think that's what we try to work on now. And then maybe in the future there will be a movement to go for more global solutions.
Thank you, Caroline. Okay, there was also this question regarding innovation, venture capital investment taxation. Any more thoughts on this? Yeah, please, Scott.
Yes. Well, I think it's clear that when you're pumping money out of the sector, you would expect both static and dynamic effects. So you would expect it not to be neutral in effect. You would expect there would be some inhibiting effect. It seems clear enough. Many of you will be familiar with Harberger's triangle, which links a lot of these things. Anything that inflates prices above the level where they ought to be at will tend to have negative impact.
Thank you, Scott. Any other question? Yes, please.
Yeah, Friedrich de Bakker, Telefonica again. Maps to and try to wrap up a bit of everything I learned today. So I understood that the principle is established and concept of all, it does not make any sense anymore. We won't get easily rid of it. And I would understand also that some countries like the US would probably advocate to keep it because they mostly have all the big online companies with their parentheses in the US. And then there is that all the incentive of the country-by-country reporting. So my question is, if is that country-by-country reporting, whatever they report, would that be enough to kind of, in a middle way, to solve the problem of the 19 versus 6% average tax payment? Was my question clear? Okay.
I have no answer. This is exactly what we're doing in the second stage of the study, actually. So what we're trying to look at now is basically whether making information more transparent and makes what kind of difference it makes and what kind of efficiency gains you have in terms of compliance in a context in which there are interactions between countries like two-sided platforms. You don't really know. You have advertisers from country A, users from country B. So that's, but for the moment, I have no answer. I'll be back maybe before 2020 to give you the answer.
I was going to say, my snap judgment is that it seems that transparency would be a step in the right direction, but it's very hard to see how the companies that benefit from current arrangements could be compelled to transfer money to the companies that lose as a result.
I didn't take my crystal ball with me today, but I guess a wild guess will be that there will be result, of course, because if you look at the problems now that at least tax administrations face, is that every tax administration is geographically bound, despite the fact that we have conventions for exchanging information, your view is limited. But once you have a view on the global position of the firm with the tax results separated into sections, then it's much easier to get the view of what's actually going on. So I think that will be useful, at least for the first step. In terms of PE, some countries actually are at times successful, for example, Germany, at trying to pick on some of the aspects of a permanent establishment right now to still fix a part of a business to a geographical location, a part of a virtual business, and tax them. You know, by changing the view of what activities are auxiliary and what activities, you know, they deny the interpretation of this activity as an auxiliary. So there are ways around it, but I would definitely feel sorry for a business that you know, apart from doing business, has to go through this litigation. So I absolutely agree with Helena that there have to be rules much simpler and much more clear to understand because, you know, businesses have to do business.
Thank you, Dmitri, and the rest of the people that answered. Other questions, comments? Yeah, please.
Just one question, which actually, first of all, DG Grow, European Commission, a question that touches upon almost everything that we discussed here before. Actually, at what extent do you believe that country-by-country reporting the new proposals for revised way to tax the e-commerce and internet services, I provide the services. Do you believe that having everybody, all countries, EU countries, third countries engaged in that plays a role in towards the efficiency that we're envisaging in this revisions. I mean that if we don't manage to get all countries engaged in that scope, then loopholes will be still existing in every plan. So this is my question.
Yeah, Dmitri, have you?
I know at least one point, it's a good question. I know at least one point where I think as far as Europe is concerned, this is an issue that will soon be decided whether it's effective or not. And particularly this is when an international corporation has a subsidiary in EU, and when the subsidiary alone does not meet the threshold for making the information public. So there are discussions whether anyone who is present on the market, I mean, within EU, but you know, the rest of the group that fills the criteria is outside of the EU, has to still provide that information. Because if this is not passed in the directive, I think it's a huge loophole. Because you have access to this big EU market, and you don't have the obligations that most of the players of the same market have. So this is definitely one issue to pay attention to.
Thank you. I don't see any other intention for someone to reply. If there is no any other question, we will move to the concluding remarks, starting from Scott this time, and we'll go to the other speakers. So, Scott, your final comments.
Well, actually, not much to add. I think that coming back to the very last question, I'd say competitive neutrality is one of the key things to obtain. And I think one of the key takeaways is it's difficult to get there from here.
Thank you, Scott. Dmitri?
Perhaps two issues that I think were pretty clear today is number one, transparency. This is probably where we start. And number two, and it actually came very clear from Scott's words, that there are some useful insights that VAT approach can offer also for corporate income tax purposes. So if we look at the where the value is created and you know the destination principle, perhaps this is the way forward.
Thank you very much, Caroline. Call for transparency, and whether we should have a national or more European-wide approach, even international collaboration would be helpful. Your final words.
Yes, I agree on this, because then I take that our option to collect the tax where the consumer is then the good option, because it fits with the new environment, with digital environment. But it's true that then the challenge is how to identify the players. So transparency there is important. Who is selling to the consumers in the country of consumption? Who are these players? And that we can only know if we have transparency. So that's why exchange of information of data is very important, and that's what we will be working on in the context of e-commerce.
Elena, Caroline mentioned about some simplification measures. We had also the argument about innovation and venture capital financing and how hard it becomes with some particular tax rules. Your final words, and what do you expect from the authorities in the future?
The simplification is, of course, something good for the multinational companies, and then maybe this kind of mini ones shop stop simplification for all level of taxation would be, of course, very radical but very good development. For the transparency point of view, I think more open discussions with the taxpayers and then tax authorities would be actually a very good development in the future as well. So tax authorities would more... authorities that would more understand what kind of business the e-commerce itself is and what's the value chain behind it.
Thank you, Elena. Francis, the final words of the event is yours.
So I want to finish on a tone of optimism. So what I think is that we heard transparency. I think that was an achievement. Actually, that was the country-by-country reporting, I believe, is going to change things. Talking to people at BEPS, I'm surprised. 2020, I'm not surprised, but it's so long. And I'm sure that people like Dmitri, who are involved in it, understand why. This just takes an incredible amount of time, negotiation, ironing things out. But I'm optimistic in the final outcome. I think that we have smart people. We're trying, as academics, we're trying to help. And I think to design the best policies. But I'm quite convinced that something is going to come out. And that we're going to be able to move out of the 1928 context into the new world of the digital world and have an appropriate tax framework for that.
Thank you very much. A word of optimism is the ideal way to close this event, especially under this weather, which signals that probably summer had arrived finally. Thank you very much for being here.